Grace, mercy, and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Good morning, Living Water. What a beautiful day it is to worship our Lord and Savior. Amen? Amen. We have a few announcements as we start off this morning. The first is in regard to that straw poll we're having in regard to our relationship with Orange City. That's taking place next Sunday, the 18th. So we encourage you to attend, not only to worship our Lord, but also so that we can get as much feedback next week after the service. Again, that will be taking place after the service next Sunday, the 18th. We will send out an email for you all as a reminder of that. Our brat fundraiser has concluded, and you may pick up your brats on Tuesday, August 20th from 5 to 7 p.m. We will have a couple of people outside. Lyle and Sandy will be helping distribute orders and a few other things, as well as Randy and Janine. We understand, however, that some of you may not be able to be there on the 20th to pick up your brats if you ordered some. And so we are asking that you either contact Sandy or contact Randy or Janine Brands if you want to set up an alternate time for your order. But once again, we are asking that you make every effort possible to pick them up on Tuesday, August 20th. And on a personal note, I don't know exactly how much we have raised via the brats, but it's in the thousands, which very much helps for our church. So thank you all. You have done a great service for God's church. Give yourselves a hand. It's been fantastic. A reminder that our Little Treasures and Children's Sunday School is kicking off on the 8th with a sort of a potluck type brunch type thing set up by the care elders after the service. And our lessons, our Sunday school lessons, regular class, starts on the 15th. So again, be here September 8th for Sunday school to start at 9 o'clock, and Little Treasures will be dismissed during the service. And then on the 15th, we will have classes that day. The reason that we're having the Sunday school kickoff on the 8th is because we, as Living Waters Sheldon, will be not having a service here at our campus on September 1st. The reason being that every year we, as churches of the Sheldon community, come together and have our community service over at the Rise Fest grounds. Many of our churches cancel their service, and instead we go worship together as one body, as the community of Sheldon. And so we're asking that instead of being here on September 1st, you join us, all of the churches, over at the Rise Fest grounds on Sunday, September 1st. The service starts at 10 a.m. Please join us for that. On a quick personal note, I'm going to be taking some time. It's been kind of a chaotic few months ever since Synod. So after service today and Monday and Tuesday of this week, I will not be in the office taking a short mini vacation. So feel free to contact Sandy, your care elder, or a council member if you need anything during that time, Sunday, Monday, or Tuesday. I believe that's all the announcements we have for this morning. Let's bow our heads before our Lord in a time of prayer. Father God, we thank you for all the ways in which your Spirit has been shown upon us throughout this week, and we look forward to the ways your Spirit will be present today. Father, as we're doing many things in this service, as we're singing songs of praise, as we're proclaiming the gospel, as we are baptizing Brother Everett, we ask, Father, that your Spirit not only would be present, but would uplift us all, so that in doing so, your holy name would be praised. May we glorify you well this morning, Father, for this is all for you. We pray this all in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
King and firm foundation, our rock, the only solid ground. The nations rise and fall. Kingdoms once strong, now shaken. Forever in your name, the name of Jesus.
You're higher, you are the only king forever. forevermore. You are victorious, you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. Unmatching all your wisdom, in love and justice you will reign, and every knee will bow. Our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus. Oh, we trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
Sorry, getting old, so now I need glasses and all the stuff that goes with that. So we used the word forever quite a bit in the song that we just sang, and the next song actually also has the word forever in it. And when those kinds of things happen, when we are listening to the Holy Spirit and we are listening to the guiding of and the prompting from Him, when there's a common word, it probably is something important. And in Psalm 92, it says, "It is good to praise the Lord and make music to your name, O Most High, to proclaim your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night, to the music of the 10-stringed lyre and the melody of the harp. For you make me glad by your deeds, O Lord. I sing for joy at the works of your hands. How great are your works, O Lord. How profound your thoughts. The senseless man does not know, and fools do not understand, that though the wicked spring up like grass and all evildoers seem to flourish, they will forever be destroyed. But you, O Lord, are exalted forever." And then in the dictionary, the word forever as an adverb means forever, without ever ending, for eternity, continuity, incessantly, always. And as a noun, an endless period of time, eternity. And as an adjective, lasting for an endless period of time. And Andrew also told me, don't go on forever and ever with this. So isn't he funny? And so forever, I just feel like it's such a meaningful thing that sometimes we don't think about much, eternity, and being able to glorify him and sing holy, holy, holy to his name for after this life. What a cool experience. And so hopefully you leave today knowing that we've thought about forever and it's meaningful to you.
Thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. You've been forgiven. If you've been redeemed, sing the song forever to the Lamb. And if you walk in freedom, and if you bear his name, sing the song forever to the Lamb. We'll sing the song forever and amen.
Holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. Hear your people sing, the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, oh, you will always be holy.
Amen. People of God, you may be seated. One of the joys that we as a congregation have is to welcome members into our fellowship, both through profession of faith as well as through the act of baptism, to be baptized members. And we have such a privilege today to welcome Mr. Everett Boss into our family. So if Nate and Kate, who are his parents, and Mr. Everett would come forward at this time. And as they do so, Nate and Kate have been with us for a couple of years. And though Everett came a bit earlier than expected, it's actually a miracle that there is not only Everett here, but he's healthy, he's happy, Kate's doing well, everyone's doing well. So already we have seen a miracle in this young man's life, and we pray that we will see more in the years ahead. Baptism is the sign and seal of God's promises to his covenant people. In baptism, God promises by grace alone to forgive our sins, to adopt us into the body of Christ, the church, to send the Holy Spirit daily to renew and cleanse us, and to resurrect us to eternal life. This promise is made visible in the water of baptism, for water cleanses, it purifies, it refreshes, it sustains. Jesus Christ is our living water. And today, we get to witness and participate in the baptism of Everett Nathan Boss. So Kate and Nate, you stand before us having brought your son to receive the sacrament of baptism. So I ask you, therefore, before God and Christ's church, do you reject evil? Do you profess your faith in Christ Jesus? And do you confess the faith of this church? What is your answer? Do you promise to instruct Everett in the truth of God's word, in the way of salvation through Jesus Christ, to pray for him and teach him to pray, and to train him in Christ's way by your example, through worship, and in the nurture of the church? What is your answer? People of living water, please rise in body, or if not able, in spirit. People of God, do you promise to love, encourage, and support this new brother by teaching the gospel of God's love, by being an example of Christian faith and character, and by giving the strong support of God's family in fellowship, prayer, and service? Living water, what is your answer? As an act of faith, let us all join together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. People of God, you may be seated. Everett, though he is asleep now. For you, Jesus Christ came into the world. For you, he died. And for you, he conquered death. All this he did for you, though you know nothing of it as yet. We love because our God first loved us. So therefore, Everett Nathan Boss, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. People of God, it is a joy to welcome this brother into our congregation and to commemorate this day. We have some gifts and we have a certificate that hopefully he can use later on in his life to remember these promises that were given today. These are on behalf of the church and the care elders. And as you see, Courtney is taking a photo. We will have a photo printed out for you and framed, so you can remember this day in his baptism as well. And on behalf of Living Water and the care elders, I think we could say congratulations. And at this time, it's only appropriate that we invite, you can stay up here, Sherry. We invite all the elders, all the council, and family and friends up as we lay hands on Nate and Kate and young Everett, lifting them up in a time of prayer. So leadership, family, and friends, feel free to come forward at this time. That's a cute picture, by the way. Isn't that adorable? My sister put her kid in a pumpkin. I like that way better. As people make their way up, Nate and Kate, what a blessing it is to have these friends, this family, and this church supporting you. And let's pray that we continue to do so in the future with both you and young Everett. Let's lay hands and bow our heads in a time of prayer. Father God, thank you for the faith of Nate and Kate as they bring their son Everett to you in the sacrament of holy baptism. As you have heard, what a joy it is to welcome this brother into the faith. And Father, we pray that this would not be just the start of his journey, but this journey would continue on throughout his life. We pray, Father, that from this day forward, Everett, even in his young age, could continue to grow in his trust, faith, and love in you and in our son, or your son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Father, we ask a special blessing upon Nate and Kate as they instruct him in the way that he should go, as they train him in the way of the faith, as they guide him into the truth of your salvation. Father, we thank you for the miracle he is and the miracle in which he was brought to them and to us. And Father, we ask that your hand would continue to be on his young life in the days, weeks, months, and years moving forward, so that his life may be a proclamation of you and his life would tell of how you have loved him. Father, for us as a church, we ask a blessing upon us as well, that we would walk well with this family. We would nourish them in times of support, and we ask that together with this family, we may all instruct Everett as he goes forth. Thank you, Father, for his life. Thank you for Nate and Kate. Father, may you bless him, and we thank you for your hand upon him. We pray this all in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Friends, let's welcome this brother with a round of applause. And at this time, let's all rise. We are going to greet one another this morning. Be sure to say congratulations to Nate and Kate. People of God, as you make your way back to your seats, as I've said many times, one of the things I love most about this church is we could talk to each other for hours, and I encourage you to do so after the service. But as we make our way back to our seats, we also want to give space for our offering, our tithes, and our gifts to our Lord at this time. And there are many ways that you can do that. You can go to forallwhothirst.churchcenter.com. You can text 84321. You can mail your donation to Sheldon or in city campuses. And as always, offering baskets will be passed here in just a second, and the kids will be invited up for noisy offering. But before we do that, I think it's only appropriate we ask God to bless the gifts that are given. Bow your heads if you would with me. Father God, Already we have seen your blessings bestowed upon us today. The blessing of song, the blessing of Everett, the blessing of his baptism. So, Father, it's only right that we give some of our blessings back to you, for they are yours. So, Father, as we give of our tithes, as we give of our gifts, we ask that they would be a blessing unto you, a blessing to your church, and we ask that they would be given out of thankful and joyful hearts, hearts that are full of love for you. We give to you, Father, out of joy. We pray this all in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Deacons, would you come forward at this time? And kids, you're invited up front for noisy offering. People of God, let's pray. Father, we thank you for the gifts that have been given. We entrust them to you, for they are yours. Use these gifts as a blessing so that this church and your people may go out and proclaim your name in both word and action. Use these gifts as you see fit so that your gospel would be told to this community and beyond. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our scripture for this morning comes from two different sources, as we've been doing the last couple of weeks. The first is from the book of Matthew. We're going to be reading verses 1 through 2 and 8. It's under the subheading, The Beatitudes. Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, followed by verse 8 as our first scripture. Starting with verse 1, it says this. Now when he saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. And then we turn a little bit later in the book of Mark, chapter 12, verses 41 through 44, which is under the subheading, The Widow's Offering. Again, Mark chapter 12, verses 41 through 44. Starting with verse 41, It says, Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury. Many rich people threw in large amounts, but a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins worth only a fraction of a penny. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, I tell you the truth, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on. Let's pray before our Lord this morning. Father God, your Spirit is with us. We have seen it through the giving of gifts, the singing of song, through the sacrament of baptism. And we ask that your Spirit would be at work through the proclamation of the gospel. So, Father, this morning, as we open your word, as we open your gospel, as we dive into your scripture, we ask that you would bless the mouth of the one who speaks on your scripture, and you would open up all our hearts so we might hear your truth within. We pray this all in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Friends in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we join together this morning in praise to our Father through the work of the Holy Spirit as today we continue our series on the teachings of Christ, in which we are examining Jesus' instructions to his people as found in the book of Matthew chapter 5, more commonly known as the Beatitudes or the Blessings. And in doing so, we further examine another passage a bit later on that gives us an example of that teaching we find in Matthew chapter 5. And thus far in this series, we've seen how Christ calls his followers to be many things. And then we see how he gives them a promised reward if they are these things. And those have ranged all the way from the command to be a people who are poor in spirit, to God's promise to be near to his people in times of sorrow and mourning, to last week, God calling us to be merciful even during times of tension. And this week, as we kind of near the end of the Beatitudes with only a few left, we look at how Jesus calls his people to be pure in heart. And he also further gives us a promise that if we do so, if we are pure in heart, we will see the Lord. And it's my hope that as we explore not only what it means to be pure in heart, but also see an example of pure in heart in Scripture, we will be inspired to purify our hearts, turning away from the things of the world and focus solely on Christ and who he calls us to be. And Jesus' teaching to be a people of pure, that are pure in heart, is found, as we said, in verse 8 of the Beatitudes of Matthew chapter 5. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. But what does this actually mean? Because unlike other things that we've covered in this series, such as being meek or showing mercy, the idea of being pure in heart can have many broad definitions. So what is Christ's meaning when he says he will bless those who are pure in heart? Well, if we look a bit earlier in Scripture, all the way back to the time of the Old Testament, specifically King David, we get a pretty good description by King David in the book of Psalms as he pours his heart out to the Lord during times of repentance, which we find in Matthew 51:10. And it gives us a pretty good definition of what pure in heart means. He says, create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. And here we see several things that describe purity of heart. The first being that it is the Lord who gives us this heart, not us. And the second being pure of heart means to steadfastly focus on the Lord. And the third being that according to Jewish thought, the heart was not only the place of our emotions, but also the place and the originator of our thoughts. And so what we have is kind of a conglomeration of the heart being both a state of mind, a state of the soul, and a state of action. And so being pure of heart meant to have a soul, a mindset of one that is totally set on God and God alone at all times. But this isn't the end of the definition of pure of heart, because Scripture not only gives us what to be when we have a pure heart, but also what not to be when it comes to our heart's purity. Because If we turn back to the New Testament, to the book of Mark, we see Jesus naming things that are in fact the opposite of who he calls his children to be. He gives us what purity of heart doesn't look like. In Mark chapter 7, verses 20 through 23, he went on, "What comes out of a man is what makes him unclean. For from within, out of men's hearts, comes evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and make a man's heart unclean." And this passage does two things. First, it shows us what is the opposite of purity of heart. And second, it shows that a purity of heart is not only a state of the soul and of the mind, but purity of heart is also a state of the hands. In other words, of the body. It's an action. And so when we add all this together, we see that Christ teaches his children that being pure of heart means to be one whose soul and mind and actions desire completely to be focused on the Lord at all times, even at the expense of everything else. One whose soul, whose mind, and whose actions desire completely to be focused on the Lord, even at the expense of everything else. Pure in heart is to be totally dedicated to God, and further, desires to be totally dedicated to the Lord in every part of life. And in order to illustrate what this looks like, we turn to a brief story in the book of Mark, where we see Jesus actually observing purity of heart in action, not by those who most would expect, but by one who was marginalized in Jewish society, that being a widow. In the first verse of this story, it sets the stage for us, which takes place in the temple courts in Jerusalem right after Jesus had got done teaching some of his people, which we find in verse 41 of Mark 12. Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury. Many rich people threw in large amounts. And here we see that Jesus is quietly watching people tithe. And person after person come up, and apparently, according to the scripture, were tossing in bags and bags of money. Now, keep in mind just a few things. First, these donation receptacles were open to the public, okay? It wasn't a private donation system. It was open to the public, meaning that other people could see what was put in. And if you want to see what these receptacles look like, we actually have a picture here. This is an artist's rendition. This is a close approximation. Notice that these are made out of copper or bronze, and they were literally just sitting out kind of in the courtyard area. One in the courtyard of women, one in the courtyard of men. They were sitting out for people to toss their money into. So everyone could see what people put in. But not only could they see it, they could also hear it. Because remember, during Jesus' time, the only money made was in the form of coins, which were made of metals. And those coins looked something like this. Each emperor had their own currency, but they were always made out of gold, silver, tin, bronze, etc., copper. And what would happen is they would take the money and they would put it into these copper vessels that you have seen. And so it wouldn't just be a show in terms of, oh, look how much money he's putting in. You could actually hear the clinking. You all heard where'd that thing go? Did the deacons take it? The deacons are stealing money, y'all. Just kidding. Brent would never do that. But you all heard what happened with the noisy offering, right? The little clink, clink, clink. Imagine that all day, every day, for weeks and weeks on end. That's what it would sound like. So people could see what others would be putting in as it was public, and they could hear that clinking noise from the coins being poured in. So, in other words, people were pouring in money, not out of necessarily faithfulness, but because it started to become a show. They were kind of bragging about how much they could throw in. They were kind of prideful. Look how much money I'm pouring in. Look at how much noise my money makes. And it's in the middle of this prideful show of wealth that Jesus sees approaching these vessels an old woman, a widow, who had absolutely nothing. And she comes to this receptacle with two small copper coins, which were basically worthless. We find that in verse 42. But a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins, worth only a fraction of a penny. Now the world would look at this woman and think, this amount won't help the temple at all. What good are these pennies? But Jesus has a totally different outlook, because Jesus sees this woman as sacrificing all that she has. In verse 44, they gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on. And upon seeing this, as we read later, Jesus calls his disciples over to point out what was taking place. And upon doing so, the Lord proclaims that this woman, out of all who were there, gave more to the Lord than anyone else. And so he not only points this out to the disciples, what a pure heart actually looks like, but this woman actually shows us what a pure heart actually looks like. Because this woman, who was a widow, who in the Jewish context had nothing, was so driven to live for God in her soul, in her mind, and in her actions, she gave all that she had to show her faith in the Lord, which is why she gave more than all the rest. Because the rest had been giving tons of money out of their wealth. They had been giving literally poundage of money to the point that they were in it for the show. But she gave everything to the Lord out of her trust and faithfulness in Him, which is why Jesus holds this woman as one who truly honors the Lord. For to her the Lord was everything, and to others the Lord was only a footnote to be participated in. For others, those who were rich in this story, they were not truly focused on the Lord. They were focused on the things of the world and gave the Lord a piece of what was left. They were focused on the things of the world like money and wealth. They gave because they could. But this woman shows us true purity of heart, for she gave all to the Lord because she was dedicated to Him. And this raises the question for us today, which is, who are we most like? Because all of us would like to be the pure in heart. All of us would like to be totally dedicated to God and desire to be totally dedicated to the Lord in all parts of life, much like the woman. But the truth is, many, all of us, are not. You fall into this temptation. I fall into this temptation. We all fall into the temptation of, instead of giving all of ourselves to God, we are tempted to focus on other things in our life, whether that be money or power or belongings or addictions. We are all tempted to be like the rich, but Jesus points out to be like the woman and pure of heart, so all of our souls, our minds, and actions are dedicated solely to our Lord. This is why Jesus holds the woman in such high esteem, because she's pure in heart, which Jesus names right after seeing this woman give what she has to offer. In verse 43, calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, I tell you the truth, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. Jesus values her because she is pure in heart. But what happens when someone is pure in heart? What are we promised if we are dedicated to our Lord and desire to live all of our lives for Him, taking upon ourselves the character of Christ? Well, in this specific woman, in the case of this specific woman, this is the end of her story, as we read. And though we read no further in Scripture the details of what happened to her, we know what happens to people like her when they live with a heart of purity. We know what blessings are bestowed upon God's people when they live a life for Him. And this promise that Jesus gives is in the Beatitudes, where we are told this blessing in the second half of verse 8. What happens when we are pure in heart? Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. The pure in heart will see God, which has two very distinct aspects to it. The first being, we will see God in our everyday life while on this earth, which means He will continue to guide us, continue to love us. He will continue to make His presence known to us, even when we're in times of struggle. And this promise of seeing God in our everyday life to the point that God will always be with us isn't just my opinion. It's actually Jesus' own words in the Great Commission of Matthew 28, which you hear me say every single Sunday, which says, "Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you." And this is Jesus' promise. "And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." To be pure in heart means that God will continue to show himself to us and embrace us, which allows us to embrace the truth that God is with us, thus giving us the strength to seek him more and more every single day. Which leads into the second aspect, because the pure of heart will not only see God in this life, but in fact, they will be with him after death in eternity. John 14 tells us that. "In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am." This is the promise of Jesus, that if we're pure in heart, that we will not only be seen and loved by God in this life, but we will be with him in the next. We are promised that the pure in heart, those who steer away from the things of the world and focus their souls, minds, and actions on solely the Lord in all things, those people will be promised eternity. An eternity which we did not earn. A heaven that we did not work toward. An afterlife that we did not deserve, but was given solely to us as a free gift from the Lord to his children by Jesus Christ's atoning sacrifice for all of us. And he died upon that cross in which he took our sins upon him, died upon that cross so that those sins may be demolished and we may be forgiven. He died upon that cross only to raise again, to defeat the devil and ascend to heaven, giving us the hope of salvation in him until he returns again. This salvation is what God's people are granted by the blood of Jesus Christ. And it is the pure of heart who put all other cares aside and live only for him that will inherit this promise, not because of our actions, but because the Lord has given us this promise first. And out of joy and obedience, we go to the Lord and say, "God, I want to live for you and only for you, for you have chosen me as yours, and I desire to live for you always, giving all to you in return." This is what it means to have a pure heart, a heart dedicated to the Lord, even at the expense of the world in which we are comfortable and tempted to focus upon. And so, my friends, in a world where we are tempted like the rich to focus on something other than Jesus, in a world full of possessions and power and money and pride and worry and anxiety, I challenge us, let us live all our lives solely to Jesus, keeping our souls, our minds, our actions, and our desires only on him, for he has already given us all of himself. And in response, out of thankfulness, we can live for him, and then we will be pure in heart. Then we will see him in this life and the next. And so it's my prayer for all of us as a church, regardless of wherever you go, that we as God's people may focus all of who we are on Jesus. And in doing so, may we be pure in heart, for already he has given all of himself to us for his glory and for our salvation. Out of thanks, may we devote all of our lives to him. Amen? Let's pray. Father God, we read this story of the widow and notice her heart's purity in that she had nothing to give except the very meager thing she had to live on. And she chose to give it to you out of trust, out of love, and out of honor. Father, we read that story, and today we think, what a blessing. We read that story, and we're temporarily inspired to do the same. But also, Father, it's so easy for us to fall away and instead act like the rich and focus on other things. And so, Father, we pray that we as your people, we as your church, we as your children, that we would be inspired by this story to be like the woman and be pure in heart, giving everything we have to you, focusing all of our lives on you, sometimes even at the expense of what's comfortable. May we give all of our minds, our souls, our hearts, our bodies, our actions, may they all be devoted to and dedicated to you, Father, out of thankfulness because you have given all of yourself to us by your Son, Jesus Christ. So, Father, this morning, we simply ask, make us like Christ. Make us pure in heart, so we devote all of ourselves to you. We pray this all in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Bow our hearts, we bend our knees. Oh Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. Oh Lord, we cast down our idols.
Give us clean hands, give us your hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, O God of Jacob.
We bow our hearts, we bend our knees. O Spirit, come make us humble. Turn our eyes from evil things. Oh Lord, we cast down our idols.
Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Generation that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Give us clean hands, give us your heart. Let us not lift our souls to another.
People of God, it never ceases to amaze me how the Spirit works. A lot of you guys may not know this, but how we work here is that I don't choose the songs because I am the most musically uninclined person in the history of ever. Basically, what I do is I give a theme, and then the worship team picks the songs. It never ceases to amaze me every single Sunday how the song that they picked and the message I gave worked hand in hand with one another, which basically said the exact same thing. I see that in two different ways. First, I see that as a sign that the Spirit is indeed with us, blessing us. And second, I see it as an affirmation, especially today. Because in His Word and in His song, He says to us, Let us go be a people devoted solely to Him, focused on Him before all things, for then we will be pure in heart, because He has given us everything. Join us next week as we continue our series, but until we see each other again, let's go and be a people pure of heart. Let's go and be a people focused with all of our decisions, our hearts, our words, and our actions, focused solely on Him and His glory. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and Son and Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything He has commanded us, for surely He is with us always to the very end of the age. Amen.